This evening on the Rock Newman Show, we talk local and national politics with former D.C. Mayor and current D.C. Councilman Vince Gray, D.C. Councilman Trayon White, and Robert White also join the discussion. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Education, community relations, economic growth, as the new year gets going, these are just a few issues on the docket for local legislators. D.C. Councilmen Vincent Gray, Trayon White, and Robert White believe they are equipped with the tools to tackle these very issues. They all join me now to give their take on the political pulse of the D.C. area, present solutions for local issues, and the impact of Trump's impending presidency. Welcome to the show, gentlemen. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Robert.
Thank you for having us.
All right. Mayor Gray, I want to go to you first. As I was driving in a little while ago, it occurred to me that you might have a perspective and insight perhaps unlike anybody else here in modern times, about how Hillary Clinton might be feeling. What am I talking about? What I'm talking about is, it is an argument certainly can be made that in large part because of the FBI's behavior, Donald Trump is president-elect and Hillary Clinton is not. What am I talking about? I'm talking about that it could be argued that perhaps you now would be serving as mayor had it not been for the FBI's behavior. So before we get into the full-blown discussion with everyone, I couldn't let this moment pass without asking you your thoughts on that and how does that make you feel? And you can, by telling us how you feel, I think you can share a little bit how Hillary Clinton might be feeling now.
Well, I suspect, I have not talked to Hillary Clinton, of course, but I would suspect that she's very angry. I was in the aftermath of what happened to me. You know, the U.S. Attorney's Office did a press conference 1 week before early voting started in my race. And we were up in every poll that had been done at that stage, internally and externally, anywhere from 6 to 13 points. And while we can't say for certain that we would have won, I think it was pretty clear that we were well on our way to re-election. The press conference that he did left people with the question of whether I was going to be charged with some crime or not. And I think there were a lot of people who said, well, I don't want to vote for those other people. And if I vote for him, it's like a throwaway vote, so I won't even bother to vote. What they did was suppress the vote. And I think that's a part of what happened in this presidential race also, that lots of people didn't show up to vote in my race. They didn't show up to vote also in Hillary Clinton's race. And of course, the outcome was the same. In my situation, nothing was ever done because they had nothing to charge me with. And in Hillary Clinton's case, you know, just a couple of days before the presidential election, they concluded that there was nothing in those emails either that they wanted to do anything further with. So while we'll never know fully exactly what the impact was of Comey's engagement, there's no question that it had an impact on people. And there are rules, there are guidelines that say that the law enforcement in the nation does not involve itself in elections within 60 days of those elections being conducted. In my case, they violated that. In the case of Hillary Clinton, they clearly violated it also. So if she's angry, she has every right to be angry. Because I think that many of us who would argue that she's been deprived of the opportunity to be president. And we don't even know the full impact of that. We won't know that fully until it starts to unfold. But I think we know that for many of us, this will be a different kind of presidency than we would have had with Hillary Clinton.
And to just finish up on that, have you made any sort of formal complaint against the against the FBI, against the U.S. Attorney's office?
Well, I talked to my attorney about that, and apparently I can't. There is no recourse for me directly, because I asked him about pursuing that. But there were people who filed complaints with the Bar Association in the District of Columbia, for example. And as far as I know, Rock, nothing has been done with that. When people have that kind of power and they're permitted to be able to get away with those kinds of things, they have to be held accountable. Yeah. You can't just allow people to go out and make accusations that are unfounded, that have egregious consequences for the individuals that are involved, as well as so many people who are affected by that, and then do nothing. There's probably a court of public opinion. You know, I ran into somebody just days ago who is in the same law firm with one of the people who was involved in this, and he was very angry about what happened. Same thing happened to me yesterday with somebody expressing their anger about what occurred. But at the end of the day, there has to be some formal accountability for people who do these kinds of things and have no way of substantiating the accusations that they make.
Trayon White.
Sir.
In looking at your bio and looking at some footage from past times, one sees that the mayor for life, Marion Barry, had a substantial influence on you. I see you come here today with kente cloth, bearing kente cloth, a signature of Marion Barry. Before we get into talking about strictly about D.C. politics and the issues and solutions, I'd like for you to weigh in on the influence that Marion Barry had on your has had on your life.
So I spent a great deal of time with Marion Barry, and probably in the last 4 to 5 years, actually, just gleaning from him. And he was like a father figure, very aggressive, very stern, but very gentle at the same time. And he had some ideologies and principles he stood on that I'd never experienced before. Like, people would attack, as I call them, MB, do stuff to him, and he'd turn around and make sure they was good after the election, help them to navigate and get settled. And I'd be like, wow, you know, because I don't know how to do that. And so I learned how to be the bigger person, how to let it go, and just about caring about the people, putting people first. That was one of the biggest things I learned about having a big heart and being fearless when it comes to leadership.
Part of what you are defining is Marion Barry not having the ability or choosing not to hold a grudge. Vince, obviously, you knew him for a long time.
Absolutely.
That was one of his very childlike and charming qualities.
Absolutely, and Marion Barry was very focused. He knew where he was trying to get to, and he worked hard to be able to get there. And what Marion Barry was great at was engaging people, helping people to understand what his agenda was in a particular situation, and then working with them to try to get there. He realized that holding grudges and fighting with people at the end of the day would probably defeat what his purpose was. Mm-hmm. And that was one of his great qualities among the many, and that was to be able to stay focused on where he was trying to get to, and obviously he was incredibly successful.
Robert White.
Rock.
You weren't supposed to win this race. You're not supposed to be on this one of the new council members just recently sworn in. Tell us about Robert White. We know Robert White proudly went to Archbishop Carroll High School.
Yes.
Give us a little insight as to what has been your path. To sit where you're sitting now.
The path has really just been one of believing in the process and wanting to step up for people who have been left behind. I come from a family that's been in D.C. since the 1860s, but I'm the only college graduate in my family, and my father, as a single father, did everything he could to make sure that while things wouldn't be easy, that I'd have the opportunity if I were going to take it. Mm-hmm. So I went on to college, went to law school, went to Capitol Hill to work for Congresswoman Norton. And as I worked on behalf of the city, and I saw the city hitting this amazing trajectory that none of us thought it may ever hit, I saw my family and folks like them being left behind. And so really without a clue as to how to run a campaign or how to be successful in the field, I quit my job with the support of my wife and ran and lost and brushed myself off, got back up, and won. We believe we could win the race with the right message, bringing people together instead of engaging in divisive politics. And at the end of the day, we surprised the city, but we knew we could do it.
Part of what we attempt to do here at this show, sitting at this table, is indeed, for those who are looking in, is to be inspirational. You just mentioned something. You don't hear the term that often, single father. Single father. Obviously, you mentioned that first, and that had a great impact and influence on you. Can you share with us a couple of examples of the fatherhood that gave you direction that allowed you to become and to achieve what you've achieved?
I'd be proud to. My father became a single father because my mother passed from breast cancer when I was 8. As much as I didn't know what I was doing in politics, he probably didn't know what he was doing in parenthood either. Yeah. But he made a way. He worked his tail off to provide opportunities that he didn't have growing up, whether it was music or engaging in sports. But the single most important thing my dad did was to show up. His father loved him abundantly, but he worked so much and so hard, he couldn't show up for my dad's sports games or recitals. And so my father said, I'm gonna take the example that my father gave me and I'm gonna do one better, one thing different. I'm gonna show up. And my father has always shown up. And anybody who saw my campaign, if you saw me, you probably saw my dad just smiling in the background and doing whatever was necessary to help me.
Yeah. Back to you, Mayor Gray. Should I be calling you Mayor Gray? Are you when you say Mayor? I mean,
I have Mayor, Chairman, Council Member.
Yeah. Okay. So,
the whole mouthful.
Bro, man.
Yeah.
With all the experience that you have, having served the city, as you took the oath of office just recently, can you share with us what you think what are the biggest challenges for the district right now?
I think one of the biggest challenges among a number will be managing growth. This city is growing rapidly, and not just growing, it's growing and diversifying in ways that we've never seen this diversity, at least in the recent past. We now, that most recent data I saw, we're now at 671,000 people, which is the largest population this city has seen in many decades, probably the 60s or the 70s. But it's not only just growing, it's also growing, frankly, you see the racial mix changing in the District of Columbia rapidly. We have no longer a majority African-American population, which is very different than what has been since probably the 60s or the 70s in the city. And we have a lot of people, you know, we both, all three of us, worked in areas where, you know, we had to recognize that people are afraid of the future at this point. You know, Councilmember Trayon White is representing Ward 8, which is a predominantly African-American population. Mm-hmm. Population of Ward 7 is predominantly African-American. And of course, Robert White, who ran all across the city, had to work hard in 7 and 8 as well, which he did. So all three of us have the challenge of trying to figure out how in the policies that we promulgate, that we promote, how do we try to assure people that there will be a place for them in the District of Columbia, that there will be jobs for them, that kids will be educated, that they will have opportunities to be able to continue to live in this city. The housing costs are going up tremendously. I'm one of those who started the investment in affordable housing of $100 million. The second year we put in $287 million. But although that sounds like a lot of money, when you start to do the math, you recognize that that really is a beginning at best in this process. So, you know, what we've got to be able to do, I think, all three of us and joining with our colleagues, is to figure out how, as this is an increasingly diverse city, an increasingly white city, frankly, how do we make sure that people who have invested themselves for decades, have stayed the course to make this city what it is today, don't get pushed out and don't feel a part of the decisions that are being made?
Yeah. Trayon, I was riding from Martin Luther King and Malcolm X Boulevard the other day. I had done something that my wife tells me that I do too often, and I had gone to Eaton at Players.
Yes, sir.
And this time she was with me. Well, instead of going Martin Luther King and coming down and going out 295 to come out to where we live in Southern Maryland, I drove down South Capitol Street, and when we got somewhere down South Capitol Street, one of the cross streets, my wife had just recently read about murders that had taken place there. Mm-hmm. And she was like, you know, why did you come this way? Isn't that where I just read? And I've looked from time to time at your Facebook posts where once again you're burying a young mm-hmm. black man, someone caught in the crossfire. You live, someone made a joke the other day that wasn't funny and said that the area you represent is Gunsmoke City. It's dangerous over there. Talk to us about some of the challenges that you face, and you know, at some point we'd like to talk about, you know, what some of the solutions might be.
So I grew up in this community, you know, so I'm very familiar with the environment. And in fact, being 32 years old, my generation and younger is involved in a lot of it on the perpetrator and victim side. And so I'm connected a lot of times with the families. And so a lot of people contacted me over the years. I think I've done at least 87 funerals. And it hurts my heart. In fact, I started this work because I started coaching Little League football.
32 years old, and you've participated.
I have three more to do coming up.
Oh my God.
Yeah, two victims of a car accident, one a victim of a homicide just a couple of days ago on 6th Street.
Yeah.
A guy who I knew as well.
Yeah.
And I say that because I think it's at a time we need to redirect resources to create solutions. Mm-hmm. We have had over 6 recreation centers, even number 11 Boys and Girls Club closed in our community. We've closed over 40 plus schools in our community. We've never fully recovered from the 80s epidemic of the crack cocaine era that swept through our community. And so we are receiving the brunt of that. And so it's imperative for me as a leader with the $13 billion downtown that we redirected to creating equity on the east of the river. And so I ran for office with those ambitions because I know it takes innovative solutions. So we started doing mentoring in Johnson Middle School. We're going to move to Hart Middle School, Kramer Middle School as well. We want to open up new recreation centers in our community. We want to ensure that we provide productive things for our young people to do and put positive role models in their faces. And we want to launch our Red Ribbon Safe Communities Initiative to put red ribbons on people's doors and cars, and so we can talk about solidarity in our community to ensure everybody is saying we want safe communities. Because it's a small few. And Dr. King said bad things happen when good people do nothing. So we're trying to inspire a new generation of good people to start being active in their community. Because back in the day, my grandma was a part of the Orange Hats. They used to walk the community, pass out flyers, the whole nine. And so we put a lot of responsibility on the police department, which we should, but the community must take a stance as well. And so with my bold leadership and those who rally behind me, we're going to do just that.
Do you feel Ward 8 is in crisis?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think we're in crisis mode from housing to homelessness to crime to the health disparities. We have one grocery store serving 78,000 residents, and so we are definitely in crisis.
And I'm sure Muriel Bowser watches this show all the time.
Okay.
What do you say to her? We're in crisis, therefore we need you and your administration to do what?
So we've listed a list of priorities and put budget items to those priorities to ensure that we've been a loud voice. And one of the things in my leadership, we want to get more residents from Ward 8 down to the city council to testify about what we need in the ward. Because a long time we depended on Marion Burry, who was a giant for the people to do it. But this is a new day and a new age where the city has changed. And so I have 7 working committees, which comprise of 133 people, and we're trying to expand that. We can talk about education, the health disparities, senior citizen issues, youth services, grocery stores in our community, recreation centers, so we can start having those conversations and providing solutions to deliver to the mayor and to my other colleagues on the city council.
Robert, as a new member walking in the door, what do you feel are the biggest challenges facing the city right now? And what do you offer to help address those challenges?
Well, the challenges, and I really think Vincent Trayon hit on them pretty directly. The most urgent challenges are our schools, affordable housing, and workforce development. To talk about what Councilmember White just said, you know, people with stable jobs and stable housing don't tend to commit a lot of crimes, and so we're really missing some of those things. But the other large challenge is the change that's happening in our city. And one of the things I said in my swearing-in speech is that people have been in this city for decades or even generations. They don't despise change, but they are naturally fearful and insulted when they feel like they are not a part of that change. And so our responsibility as members of the government, as representatives for these people, is to make sure that they can be a part of the change that they're seeing in the city.
Education. There's a new chancellor. Mm-hmm. Did the leadership of Kaya Henderson improve education? And what are you looking for in the new chancellor to advance where the education system is right now?
I'm absolutely convinced that that Kaya's leadership made an impact on public education in the District of Columbia. I was proud to have appointed her as a chancellor, and she was there for essentially 6 years in that role. One of the things that it brought, frankly, was stability to the position, because if you look at the what used to be called superintendent, then chancellor, there was just enormous turnover in those positions. You could count on every 18 to 24 months there being a new leader. And when you have a position like that that's never stable, you wind up with an unstable public education system. So, one, I think she brought stability. And I think if you look at the test scores during that time also, they went up. One of the things that I'm proud of too, Rock, is working with her, because I did the legislation to create the kind of early childhood education program we have in the city at this point. We have, our pre-kindergarten program is second to none. We have 85% of our three-year-olds that go to school all day, every day, and virtually every four-year-old in the city goes to school all day, every day. So I think being able to incorporate that into our public education has been hugely mm-hmm. important. And then frankly, another thing that I'm a big supporter of is frankly family choice. That families now have choices about where their kids will go to school in a public education environment. You know, it could be a DC public school, which we've invested a lot of money to improve the buildings. You look in Trayon's ward with Blue High School, which is your alma mater, is that mm-hmm. right? We put $163 million in what I think, from a building perspective, is the finest high school we have yes, in sir. The city at this point, without question. and I was glad to work with Marion Barry and then Trayon, you know, to be able to get that done as mayor. So, but we also have a charter system. We have 65 different charters in the city now, and 118, 120 different schools. So it gives parents an opportunity to make choices about where their kids go to school. You know, and it's almost like the drive for hire, you know, system that we have in the city. Mm-hmm. Where there's competition, things will get better. We have competition in that with Uber and taxi cabs and Lyft and all those. And we now have a competitive environment in our public education system as well, which is giving lots of people, lots of parents, lots of children, a chance to be able to figure out where they want to pursue public education. So Kaya's role was huge in helping us move the ball down the field. And what I hope for the new chancellor is that he will bring also innovation, that he will bring ideas, he will bring engagement, because one of the worst things to do is to come here and be the chancellor and then not involve people in that process. It is a very hard, very difficult job, but it can be made easier by people feeling like there's room for them to be able to advance their ideas and work with the education leadership to make things better.
Trayon?
So I had the opportunity to serve on the DC State Board of Education for a few years. And one of the things we did with our education system is that we started going back to focus on some careers and vocational training in some prospective schools. I think we have to put a lot of resources and energy into doing that even more. One of the things I noticed in D.C., we toot a lot of horns about how education is moving forward, but the gap for African-American boys is getting wider and wider, and they're achieving less and less. And so I think we need to redirect how we think about that and not just teach towards the test and deal with the holistic child, because our children face so many different issues and barriers coming to that door every morning. And we got to put nonprofits and other service providers back into the schools to provide where our teachers can't. We have a new teacher regime in the district, mostly young Caucasian teachers that may not have the cultural competencies to get our kids where they need to get to. And so we have to start creating and thinking about how we change education as the world changes to make sure we are redirecting how we educate our kids.
You know, I used the word before. I asked the question about did you feel it's crisis time mm-hmm. in Ward 8. When you mentioned about the gap between sort of the general population and education and black boys, can you elaborate on that a little further?
So I do a lot of work with youth. I grew up doing a lot of work with youth. I got into community activism because when coaching for my first football team, we lost four of those young men to homicide, all under the age of 16 years old. The first one was Jay Rock inside of Belusing High School, Devin Fox, Brandon, Pookie. The list went on, and we up to nine from that same team. And I said that to say, when I encounter these young men in the streets, they can identify by seeing me. They see me in themselves, but they're trying to figure out how can they get to the next level, how can they get the skills they need to get employment, how can they get off the streets, because the recidivism in the prison system is outrageous. And so when I hear and see that, it tugs on my heart to figure out what can I do as a leader to ensure we create a pathway to the so-called middle class. And so now we've got a lot of entrepreneurs. We work with a lot of returning citizens. In fact, I introduced a bill yesterday to expand those who have records can get expunged in the time limit, shorten the time limit which they can apply to get a record expunged. And so we're taking the correct measures to ensure that we can participate in what we call the American Dream right here in the District of Columbia.
Robert?
I think Trayon really hit the nail on the head. There's such a divide in terms of progress and in terms of how our African-American students are doing in our schools and how others are doing. And so I think to Kai Henderson's credit, we have more kids enrolled in our public school systems now and our test scores have gone up. But our real challenge now, really what has to be the focus of the new chancellor, is cutting that gap, that achievement gap that we're seeing for our African-American students. The reality is that all of these kids start the same. But something is happening in this system where our African-American students are not achieving in the same way.
Do we know what that something is?
I don't think that we do. I think that we know some large pieces of it, and I think some of the largest pieces happen outside the classroom. When kids are in unstable houses, mm-hmm. when they don't know what they're going to eat for dinner, where they're going to sleep at night, they're just not going to do that well in school. And so that stability at home, that family stability, is part and parcel of these kids doing better in school.
You talk about family stability, which leads right into a question that I wanted you guys to address. There is the continuation of an enormous amount of resources, maybe per capita, and for the size of the city, more resources than any other city that deals with homelessness, yet there seems to be what many identify as chronic homelessness. How, as optimistic and as much of a can-do attitude as Marion Barry had, who we spoke of earlier, Marion once, I was riding in the car with him, and he once said, I don't know if we're ever gonna be able to solve this problem. What can we do to impact
it? Well, you know, it starts with some of the things that both Robert and Trayon talked about, and that is, a part of stability is being able to have some predictability, whether you have a job or not, you know, whether your home is going to be a place that you can be on a regular basis. And we have enormous uncertainty in those areas. In fact, if you look at the homeless population in the District of Columbia, there really are three groups. They're the singles folks, if you will, adults who you see on the streets, you know, people who are hitting you up for 25 cents or, you know, a dollar, whatever the case may be. And these are often people who have substance abuse problems and have mental health problems. I just last evening, I was down on 14th Street, and there was a person sitting there who was basically talking to himself.
Yeah.
And we have lots of people who are in those kinds of situations. And, you know, many people blame the absence of a mental health system that people can turn to now with some confidence, and same with the substance abuse programs. And then we got families. We got huge numbers of families in the District of Columbia, and elsewhere for that matter, who are without a stable place to live. We've got D.C. General, then we had D.C. Village before that. I know when I was the mayor, we had 250 families at D.C. General. Mm-hmm. And we had another 125 or 30 families who were in hotels. We still have 250 families in D.C. General. And the last time I looked, we have north of 500 families who are in hotels.
Yes.
Which, imagine the impact on a child to get up in a shelter every day, you know, and then going to school, sometimes with the same clothes on that they had yesterday.
That they slept in.
That's right. And then having to explain to your peers, they ask you where you live, which is a common question. Then you answer, I live in a shelter. Or they, you know, fake their way through it so they don't have to answer the question. You know, and when we talk about homelessness, we talk about the psychological impact, especially on families and children. And that is a huge issue for so many of our children who then have to cope with that. And again, you look at the number of children who are in shelters at this stage, and frankly, in our city, they're virtually all African-American children who come out of unstable homes in the first place. You know, there is no easy answer to any of this, but I firmly believe too, Rock, and I alluded to it before, that the earlier we can get children into educational situations, and there is no point that's too early. Mm-hmm. You know, you get a child into an educational developmental situation when she or he is 6 months old. Mm-hmm. That may be too late already because of the prenatal care mm-hmm. that needs to be provided. But what it does, not only for them, but it gets their mothers, and in case where their fathers are involved, the opportunity to be able to do something different with their lives. I have not met a mother or a father yet who didn't want to see their children do well. Mm. Our job is to try to create an environment within which they have a possibility of making that happen. And that's what we got. That's a part of solving homelessness, frankly.
I've got to ask this question. In terms of everyone was really just sworn in, but in one form or the other, you've dealt with the council through the years. Do you feel as if your white colleagues on the council have the kind of sensitivity and progressive ideas that can help impact your more troubled parts of the city? Trayon?
I'm just meeting a lot of my colleagues. So starting off, I give them the benefit of the doubt, but I think it's incumbent that we hold and push everybody to care about what our agenda is. I think the three of us on this stage here share a lot of commonalities. And so with all of us on the council, we have a lot of influence in ensuring that our colleagues can speak the same message. If they don't, you know, we rally around what their issues are. We get them to see our issues and push that to the max. And to your point of homelessness, I had a situation where we did programs with some of the youth. We was at Knox Senior Home, doing a program with some of the seniors, I'm sorry. And a lady walked up to me with her cell phone and showed me a bed, a lamp, and a dresser. And I was like, what is this about? She was saying that she was living in a storage bin. She was over 60 plus years old, living in a storage bin. I was thinking like, hey, where's she taking a shower? You know, how did she get here? And, you know, how is she charging her phone? And we work with Anita Bond's office and help her get housing. But that's happening too often in our city where we're progressing and have a lot of prosperity, but the average citizen is not feeling that prosperity.
To that point, I would say that I think my colleagues do appreciate these issues and the importance of these issues. What's somewhat different, though, is that the stakes are a little bit different for me and probably for these gentlemen here. That is to say, you know, if we have good intentions but we get it wrong, our failure falls disproportionately on my family and people like my family. My brother's a returning citizen. Most of my family has been priced out of this city. I have many different family members stacked on top of each other in two-bedroom houses. And so what you'll see from me, and really I think from them as well, is a commitment to getting it right. And that means that we have to take our progressive values, but we also have to balance that with the economic costs that may come. And what's important at the end of the day is that we have to be right, because if we're wrong, people hurt in a real way.
And soon, Donald Trump will take the office of oath of the to become the President of the United States of America, which, even though the District of Columbia citizens don't have a right to vote, they're still in the United States of America.
At least we can vote in the presidential race.
Right.
Now.
Yeah.
How do you guys, you know, does this concern you? What do you think is going to be the impact of a Trump presidency and how it might impact Washington, D.C.?
Well, I personally, because I don't want to speak for Robert or Trayon, they speak well for themselves, but I'm deeply concerned about what this means. We didn't expect it to happen. We have things that are important to this city. I think he got 7% of the vote in the District of Columbia, so that doesn't bode well for a relationship that would advance our priorities. But I think the worst thing that we can do is just assume that under his presidency we'll get nowhere, recoil, and then just, you know, be on the defensive constantly. Mm. I think we need to continue to advance our priorities. You know, statehood has far less of a chance of happening now under him than it would have under Hillary. But at the
with
same
the
time,
with the Republican-controlled Congress and Senate.
That's right. Yeah. And you know, so we've got to be on the offensive to continue to promote those things that promote the city. But we've also got to work hard to defend the things that are important to us. You know, we have budget autonomy there where we can make some decisions about how we spend our own money. We don't have legislative autonomy yet. Eleanor Holmes Norton, who is our longstanding congresswoman, 25, 26 years she's been there, she has no vote in the Congress. We need to continue to fight for that, even though we may think it will fall upon deaf ears in a Republican-controlled House and Senate and the White House. We need to continue to make the case for why that's important. You know, we'll have another election in 2 years, you know, with the House. And we need to make sure that Democrats understand what's important to the people of the District of Columbia and working now to try to change the composition of the House of Representatives so that we have a Democratic House at the end of 2 years from now.
Trayon.
For me and our community, we just feel like the struggle continues, you know. But I think this election showed that it's time for us to start working together more, you know, on fighting for what we need. You know, we don't have time to let our differences divide us anymore. I'm unsure what the president-elect is going to do, but so what we started doing in our office is going through those who were elected and sending letters. We haven't sent any letters yet, but we started drafting what those letters going to look like to let them know what our issues are. East of the river in Washington, D.C., we're here, we're neighbors, and we care about creating a better quality of living in the district. And so we're going to start those conversations. We're going to go to the Hill, you know, we're going to talk to different Congress members. We're going to talk to those who may not share the same opinion to say this is what we need. And so instead of being afraid and waiting, we've always been in a struggle. We always feel like we got the short end of the stick. So there's nothing new for us. Yeah. But we're going to band together and show we fight together.
I'm not a sensationalist. Mm-hmm. I'm very concerned. When I worked for Congresswoman Norton for a number of years and worked on D.C.'s budget every year, and of course Vince was mayor, and he knows this. Every opportunity they get to try to impose guns mm-hmm. on D.C., to pull back our needle exchange, which is largely responsible for significantly reducing the amount of HIV and AIDS cases in D.C., rolling back our marijuana laws. I think we're going to see a lot of this, and it's going to be a difficult 4 years for D.C., and I think that really our only hope is that the midterm elections in 2 years will change one of the houses of Congress and make it a little mm-hmm. Harder for them to bully D.C., but I think we have to be prepared mm-hmm. to really come together and fight together.
Let me ask you just procedurally. So does the D.C. Council get invited to the inauguration?
Of course, we have a reviewing stand right in front of the Wilson Building. And I don't know how many will be there.
That is my question. Yeah. That is my question. Do you guys intend to participate in the inauguration?
I think I have something to do that day.
I won't be there. Some of my residents did send me emails. They want to go, so I put some of their names on the list, but I won't be there.
Why not?
It just seemed like a meeting run for a lot of chaos. I've been watching some of the YouTube videos of some of the protesters on both ends, and it seemed like it could be a bit much, if not monitored correctly. And it's just too close to home.
So let me ask you further, as a true Marion Barry disciple, does it feel Jesus and Marion Barry? Does it feel like if you attended, that would be supporting something and someone that would be a betrayal of the principles of which you hold near and dear?
I don't think so. My leadership style, and I've taken a lot of stances on a lot of things, a lot of people feel comfortable with decisions I made. We saw that, and I ran against an incumbent to raise over $500,000. Mm-hmm. They really believe in where I stand out, and I never do anything I can't explain, you know? Mm-hmm. So I always live by that principle as well. So coming to an event, this is definitely the President of the United States of America, so you gotta respect the seat nonetheless. Mm-hmm. And so I don't think so. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But nevertheless, you won't be there that day.
I got something to do this with you.
We're going to the same place.
Don't know where it is yet, but you're going there anyhow. Robert?
I won't be there. I just think, you know, in this business, you have to get along with a lot of people you don't agree with. But just fundamentally, the principles of my integrity just don't agree with so much of what was said on the campaign trail. Found it hurtful as an African American, as a brand new father of a little girl. I found it hurtful to women, and it's really just something I can't wrap my head around yet.
You know, Robert put his finger on something that we should not lose sight of, Rock, and that is, we've got to be able to work with people. And we should remember, too, that not everybody who's a Republican is our enemy. Mm-hmm. The reality is that there was a Republican congressman who helped us get as close as we've ever been to Mrs. Norton having a vote. Mm-hmm. And that was Tom Davis, mm-hmm. who worked hard. He was brokering a deal that would have gotten a vote for the District of Columbia's congressional representative, while Utah got a vote also. Mm-hmm. The appeal of it was that for those who count numbers, which is everybody, of course, Utah almost clearly would have had another Republican vote. We would have had a Democratic vote.
Right.
And frankly, it was because of some other folks who put, you know, poison pills into the mix that we didn't get it. But we should not forget the fact that it was Tom Davis, a Republican congressman from Northern Virginia, mm-hmm. who really was our champion on that. Mm-hmm. I worked very closely with Daryl Issa, who is a Republican leader. When they tried to shut down the city, in 2013, along with the federal government being shut down, mm-hmm. we had a press conference up on the Hill that Mrs. Norton was at. Mm-hmm. But also speaking with us was Daryl Issa, who was chairing the Oversight Committee as a Republican for the District of Columbia. Mm-hmm. He had a piece of legislation that would have freed the District of Columbia from that ever happening again. We made advances as a result of him working with us, working with Mrs. Norton, so that we now are free of that. So we shouldn't conclude that, you know, because somebody has the R label on their, you know, title, right. that they therefore are the enemy. And frankly, there's some instances where if you have a D label, it doesn't mean that you also support everything that we do. Mm-hmm. So let's reach out to people and work to try to make sure that we take people, you know, as they are, because their values, their principles, their approaches may be consistent with ours.
Vince, there has been a lot said, a lot of speculation made about what will be your ability to work with and get along with Muriel Bowser.
Mm-hmm.
Can you address that issue?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. I've said to people that, you know, I don't come there to just to create problems. That's mm-hmm. not constructive. Mm-hmm. There's 72,000 people in Ward 7 who elected me to represent them. And that means fighting for policies that are important to their futures, and it means fighting for things that will defend reprehensible kinds of things that happen. So the reality is there will be some days when there will be policies that Mayor Bowser will promote that I'll be happily supportive of. Mm-hmm. And there will be times when things happen that I'm not supportive of. Let me give you for instance. Trayon talked a little earlier about the importance of recreation and recreation centers. We have a new recreation center being started in the District of Columbia that was built. And frankly, it is a disgrace the way that place was built. Mm. I couldn't begin to give you every issue that's wrong. But a gymnasium, for example, where they built the lighting under the basket in one instance, and on the other end of the court, there is no lighting. Not absence of a light bulb, no fixtures at all.
Oh, my.
How do you do that? A gas piping that was put in, meters that were put in outside, that actually blocked the bathroom, that are not even complying with ADA rules, in my opinion. So a person who is in a wheelchair or with a walker can't even get into the bathroom. There's so many other features about that are bad. I have taken that on, working with the advisory neighborhood commissioners who represent that area. This is a case where the mayor needs to be as outraged as I am about this, and needs to get out there and hold accountable the people who were responsible for this and say, look, you're going to make this right. Even if this means we got to start over again, this is what we're going to do to make this right. And I say that, Rock, just to say that, no, I don't come to this with a position that says no matter what you stand for, I'm opposed to it, mm-hmm. or whatever you support, I'm in favor of it. I take each issue on its face and try to support and work for the people, fight for the people who I represent. And that's the position that I will continue to hold throughout this effort.
If I'm not mistaken, the mayor supported your opponent in your race.
Yep.
You gonna be able to get along?
I just feel like with a sitting mayor, I have to work with everyone. As a new incoming council member, this is my first time, just learning the ropes as I go. But I have a clear and direct vision for what we need in our ward. So I'm gonna be communicating with that with everyone who can contribute to that. Mm-hmm. So that's my main focus.
She was on the wrong side of mine too, Rock.
But,
but that's politics, and I'm mission focused, you know, on getting things done. And that means I do have to work with the administration. I agree with a lot of the things she does, and I disagree with some of the things that she does, but that's gonna be the case with anybody. And I think that what I hope people will expect from me, and really from others on the council, is that, you know, I'll disagree with my friends and I'll agree with my enemies. Really, at the end of the day, it's about getting work done. And if that's all of our focus above politics, I think we're going to be good for the city.
You know, I think as we should, we have attempted to address the challenges that face this city and talk about some possible solutions. Now, let's kind of flip that script a little bit. I ride around the city and I continue to say, this is my favorite city in the whole wide world. So very much about it makes it that. So the person in Iowa or the person in Chicago or Florida that is considering, well, I'm considering moving to DC, but I don't know for sure. Let's talk about some of the reasons that DC's population has grown and why Bob and Sally 1,000 miles away should, yeah, it's okay for you to pull that trigger and come on in. What's so great about DC?
Our restaurant community is one of the strongest in the country.
Okay, I'm
sold. Our arts community, we have jazz singers, we have painters, we have diversity in this city, we have hubs of education. I can't imagine what you couldn't love about this city.
I completely concur with what Barbara just said, and you look at the growing economic opportunity in the city as well. We are rapidly becoming a technology hub. We created a technology corridor from the convention center up to Petworth. We helped 1776, which is an organization that creates startups. We put money into them to help them get started. And today they have 260 startups that are, you know, going to be spun off. Some of them already have spun off to create more jobs for people. You know, we're not quite the Silicon Valley at this stage as what you would find in the San Francisco area, but we're growing rapidly. I think there's just an enormous opportunity for people to come and be able to realize whatever their dreams are. It's a land of the free and the home of the brave, if you will, in the District of Columbia. Not quite the free, but you know, we're working to get there.
What has been a perpetual problem in civics and government is how to try to manage the opportunity of gentrification and maintain a identity for people who are being gentrified out. Trayon, gentrification has found Ward 8. One, what has been the attraction? And two, what's your thoughts on how to manage that, where you invite the opportunity for those who come in who can expand the tax base, but at the same time maintain the identity of the area where so many are being replaced?
I think one, we welcome all people to our ward. I think that we have to do a better job in ensuring that those who live there can stay there. Councilmember Lisa Silverman started some legislation yesterday called Displacement Free Zones, in which we talked about a lot on my campaign, in which I co-introduced to ensure that those who live in areas hardest hit by development can stay there. Because what we are focused on DC a lot is talking about economic development, but little conversation about people development. And I think we have to put the necessary resources behind ensuring we create trade programs, create pathways to the work class, to different incentives and getting high school students back. And we should be recruiting students from that graduate from high school, go to college, to come back and work in the district. Well, we don't. We got people that come from all across the country that come and work here while we're fighting for a job once completion of college or trade or in various industries. And so we're concerned what's going on in Ward 8, because as my property value goes up, I got to earn more money, but we're so far behind, we have to put resources to create a level playing field. And so that's our biggest concern in Ward 8.
Something that has been on the news for the last several years, prominently, is policing. Where do you, what's your guys' view on where D.C. is in terms of policing, how it is relating to the community properly and improperly?
So let me be honest. I've had my number of issues with D.C. Police Department. For instance, about 4 months ago, I got a call from some young guys saying he was doing a visual for a young brother in Trenton Park. And I knew it was going to be some tension, so I didn't know if I was going to go because I had my son with me. Mm-hmm. I went to the event. I didn't stay long because I saw that it was a lot of drinking, there was a lot of people out. So, you know, I reached out to MPD just to have presence. Don't stop what they're doing, just have presence in case anything happened. I get to my house, about 45 minutes later, I hear gunshots going for about 4 to 5 minutes. Man, I mean, it sounded like a war zone.
Yeah.
So now I call one of the lead officials in the police department to figure out what was going on. I thought it was a shootout between the police. Kind of found that the police came and left. When they left, it was a big old shootout, and two people got hit, innocent people over the age of 40 that wasn't even out there when I was there. We got to do better. It's people getting shot in the same areas all the time. And so I'm trying to figure out how we allowing that to happen. And so I went to the PSA meeting this week, talked to the new chief Newsham and some of his commanders and captains to ensure that we do a better job of communicating what's going on, and then getting people more involved as well. They're getting out there in the communities, and so we have a Safeway Home Act that we're going to be introducing to ensure we can provide after-school programs, tutoring, mentoring, and activities in the areas that's hardest hit by crime, because we can't just keep standing and letting it happen. I'm tired of doing the visuals and the funerals, quite frankly.
I just did a couple of bills. I'm deeply concerned, as Trayon is as well, about what we do with policing in the city. I just introduced a couple of bills that would authorize an increase in the strength. We authorize up to 4,000 police officers at this stage. The published numbers are around 37, a little over 3,700, and I think when you subtract out those who really are not on the streets, another 250 down, we probably are down 500 or 600 police officers on the street at this stage. Mm-hmm. We are a growing population of people. We got lots of new developments in the District of Columbia. And frankly, when you look at the east end of the city, it's where we see the highest levels of violent crime. Ward 7, for example, we saw 31 homicides in 2015. That went up to 39 in 2016. And both of those are numbers that are substantially higher than my years as mayor. So I want to have us go up to 4,200 police officers, but we got to make sure that they are trained properly around what community policing is and their own relationships with the community. A second bill that I introduced is one that would do the following. It's amazing how few first responders actually live in the District of Columbia.
Yeah.
We have maybe 25% of our police officers who live in the District of Columbia, and even fewer of our firefighters, 19 to 20%. So the bill that I've introduced would allow those who live in the city to not have to pay D.C. income taxes, which we hope will be an incentive. The benefits will be tremendous, one, to them personally. Yeah. But secondly, imagine when you ride down the street and you see a parked car that is a police car in that particular neighborhood. Yeah. I know it makes people think twice about, you know, whether they are going to do something untoward or not. So we've got to do more to be able to create those kinds of incentives for people, and to recognize that in a growing city, we need to have a police force that is, fully populated.
Mm-hmm. One of my questions was to Chief Newsham was, is there any technology to detect guns?
Yeah.
Saturday night, I had to ride to the hospital with a family of a young man, Devin Hall, who passed. Mm-hmm. When I found out what happened, his car was shot was 20-something times in the community. That was probably an automatic weapon. These young men are carrying extended clips of 30, 40, 50 rounds with them. Wow. And we're trying to figure out where the gun's coming from. And then it's wintertime.
Yeah.
So they're carrying them on their persons as they're walking to and fro. And it's common now.
Yeah.
And so it's on site. And we have to figure out a way to get these guns off the street, figure out where they're coming from. And because if you got young men that can't read, or young ladies for that matter, we can't discount the young ladies that can't read, don't have good communication skills, but they have an automatic weapon on their possession. You know what I'm saying? And so we got to change dynamics of how we think.
I'm gonna leave on a high note. We have about a minute and a half left. I want to start with you, Robert. What's your favorite Chuck Brown concert?
Oh.
the most difficult question of all.
Anyone where he sang Wind Me Up and went till 2 in the morning, which was every single one.
Trey, you had to pick one.
I've never been to a Chuck Brown concert. I've never been to a Chuck Brown. Shout out to Cookie, because she just asked about you as well.
You never been to a Chuck Brown concert?
I have not.
That disqualifies you. Vince.
Chuck Brown was a good friend of mine, and I have been to many Chuck Brown concerts, and I really don't want to pick out one over the others. I always enjoyed him, and you may know we did a memorial to Chuck over in Ward 5 over on 20th and Evart Street.
Beautiful.
Because we have so many monuments in this city, but we had none for people who are indigenous to the District of Columbia.
Yes,
we got the Lincoln Memorial, Washington, and all that stuff.
Yes.
But now we got a Chuck Brown memorial so that those who didn't know Chuck or have heard his music firsthand will get to learn more about him by going to his memorial at 20th and Evart Street.
You know, and I think he was so deserving of it.
Oh,
we recently did a show on Chuck and talked about what a galvanizing force he was.
Absolutely.
And I think that, you know, we expect you guys to continue in the spirit of Chuck Brown with that galvanizing spirit. Thank you so much for joining us. That wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye and God bless. And as Vince Gray said, it don't mean a thing in D.C. if it ain't got that go-go swing.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.